All right. Hello, everyone. We're group 14. We're going to talk about the effects of shoreline arming or coastal development on marine ecosystems. Next slide. Okay, so what is shoreline arming? Shoreline arming is the process of constructing buildings close to the shoreline that prevent erosion and hence protect the land above it and the buildings that are on that land. So what is erosion then? Erosion is a natural process that is caused by wave action, currents, and also wind that both degrades coarse sediments into finer ones and also displaces these sediments. So like you can see how that can ruin the foundations of buildings. And then shoreline arming occurs in most shoreline communities as it's essential to stabilize foundations of buildings and prevent any changes in the ground. And here you can see a picture of a seawall, which is a form of shoreline arming that prevents the ground above it from moving or being displaced. Next slide. All right, so there's different methods for shoreline arming, where they either focus on preventing or lowering the effects of erosion or preventing the flow of sediment. So first we have seawalls and bulkheads, as you saw in the previous slides, that are walls and structures that prevent the movement of sediment above them. And then you have groynes, as you can see in the top picture. They're long perpendicular like structures that are usually placed on beaches that prevent the longshore movement. So movement along the beach, not like out into the ocean, but along the beach. And then there is also breakwaters, which are typically placed offshore that prevent the buildup of large waves and currents. So preventing the erosion of sediments. Next slide.
Although shoreline armoring protects seaside communities, the construction of protective structures on beaches interrupts the dynamic nature of intertidal ecosystems, which can lead to adverse ecological effects. The physical effects of shoreline armoring can alter the environment in a number of ways. One example being placement loss, which is the footprint of armoring structures, causing a direct loss of shoreline habitat. This occurs especially in high energy environments, since bigger dimensions are needed for stability. Secondly, deflection of wave energy causes beach erosion, which decreases the size of intertidal habitats. In addition, shoreline armoring conflicts with the hydrodynamics of the aquatic environment, shifting the soft sediment dynamics and altering water flow. The presence of armoring structures also causes ecological changes. For example, the reduction of coastline habitats also leads to the disappearance of vegetation along shorelines. Coastline species abundances lower over time, since some coastal fauna may have used the vegetation as refuge from predators. Another example is the disruption of habitat connectivity due to shoreline armoring decreasing the width of the intertidal transition zone due to the lowering elevation between terrestrial marine habitats. Since shoreline armoring alters coastline environments, species that rely on these areas as their habitat end up being impacted. One example is the construction of armoring structures on the nesting beaches of sea turtles. Restricting access to upper beaches reduces the distribution of sea turtle nests along coasts because of the lack of remaining space left behind on beaches. Therefore, since the eggs are forced to hatch in lower beach areas, there's an increased risk of egg mortality, especially due to beach erosion.
So historically, these shoreline armoring structures have been built to try and prevent land from being lost to the sea, but they can have usually the unintended side effect of actually speeding up the loss of the shoreline to the sea. And then you can see in the figure I have here that a normal beach retreat would actually keep the width of the beach, you know, pretty similar to how it was, just eating into the land slowly. But with the building of a shoreline armoring structure, it blocks that beach retreat and then preventing the beach from moving inland while the width of the beach slowly decreases until eventually it's all water up till the structure. Next slide, please. So moving forward to the present day, like the effects of these can really be seen after the shoreline armoring structures have been there for a long enough time to see this. So there's noticeably less biodiversity since the width of the beach is decreasing greatly over time. You know, there's not enough intertidal space for the predators or the grazers to move up and down the shore. And as on top of this, there are changes in sediment. So as it's been said before, the sediment actually has more chance to settle because of the less motion of water. So the coarser sediment actually holds water less. It holds water less, so it's less habitable for those burrowing organisms. And then in the future, more shoreline armoring structures will probably need to be built because it's a domino effect. The building of one of these structures will actually increase the amount of shoreline loss on adjacent structures. So it's just a domino effect. You have to build more to protect more. Hopefully these softer approaches will be used to lessen the impact in the future. And that'll be talked in the next section.
Yeah, so some of the solutions to this problem, we can start with community planning, and this just involving homeowners and also planners who work for specific agencies within cities to choose less harsh structures, basically. So instead of maybe a harsh vertical wall, rubble would be a good compromise because it's a little bit more natural. But even better than that is to install living shorelines, which, as you can imagine, it's just a living shoreline with native vegetation that's planted. To kind of restore the ecosystem back to its previous state a little bit. And that's a little bit following into that is restoration as well. But first, on the wider scale a little bit is regulation. So this could be federal policy or non-governmental institutions as well. So examples are coastal regulatory departments that might exist from state level, provincial level, wherever you are, as well as local planning permit programs that can decide what can and cannot be built. And like I said earlier, restoration, so the removal of structures that are harmful and instead allowing the ecosystem to return more to its natural state. And you can see the figure on the screen is kind of showing the results of a successful shoreline restoration project. And on the whole, as in the global scale, overall there should be more awareness of the economic incentives of maintaining these habitats. Not only for food for humans, but also for non-humans and organisms in the water that we still rely on as well. And also pointing out the carbon capture that these primary productivity habitats offer with, you know, capturing that carbon in the plants that are available in those habitats. And of course, the global implementation of local solutions is truly what will actually help this problem. So as a whole, all across the world, these solutions should be taken in wherever the context sees fit for each part of the world, each region. So overall, protecting coastal ecosystems along the shore comes down to global efforts and coordination for both humans and non-human beings. And so less focus on the temporary solutions that might seem available that are the more harsh structures to stop the coastal erosion, and more focus on long-term ecosystem-based approaches that have more of an impact and can actually restore the coastal ecosystems back to more of their natural state. So thank you.